Hello everyone, and thanks for watching Edupedia World Videos. So in this session of states of matter, we'll finally start with the concept of real gas. Okay, so we'll look into what real gases are, how they are different from ideal gas, and why those differences arise, and how can we predict the behavior of a real gas. Okay. So first, real gas are nothing but all the gases. Okay, real gases are nothing but all the gases you see around the world. The ideal gas that we studied doesn't actually exist, right? Ideal gas is a theoretical model, a theoretical concept which we devised in order to understand real gases. Okay, so all the gases around the world are basically real gases that you see in your daily life. You don't actually see, but you can feel them, like the air inside your room right now. It has carbon dioxide, nitrogen, oxygen. They will all be included in real gases. Okay, the gases existing in real world. These gases do not obey the gas laws under all conditions of temperature and pressure. Gas laws means what we have already studied: Boyle's law, Charles' law, Avogadro's law, Gay-Lussac's law. So all those laws are not obeyed by real gases under all conditions of TNP. They will at some point of time agree, okay, the same behavior as shown by gas laws, but at other times they will show different behavior. Okay, for example, for say gas, one of the gas law says that pressure is directly proportional to temperature. Okay, so for an ideal gas this is true. Okay, for the gas which are based on kinetic molecular theory, pressure is directly proportional to temperature. But for real gases, we'll see that this is not valid under all the conditions. Okay, this might be valid at some conditions of temperature and pressure, but for other conditions they will not have a direct relationship. Maybe a little bit different, there might be some other factors coming in. Okay, it might be like pressure is proportional to T plus something whole square, or you know, we don't know. Okay, we'll see that later on. But the exact variation between temperature, pressure and volume won't be the way that we have already studied in gas law. Okay, they will qualitatively be somewhat like that, but there will be some kind of deviation, some kind of you can say error between what we have studied and what we will actually observe here. So as a result of this, the graphs of real gases will show some deviations from ideality. Okay, for example, we'll just look at the graphs also. Okay, in this same session, towards the end, we'll plot the graph of say pressure versus volume of real gas and then ideal gas, and see what kind of deviations are observed over there. So just remember that real gases are the actual gases, and what we have studied is an ideal gas. Okay, and now we are going to use what we have studied for real gases. So why are real gases different from ideal gases? Why is there a deviation from ideality? Okay, so this is what we have to answer over here. So there are two basic reasons why there is a deviation from ideal behavior. First reason is that molecules have a finite volume. Okay, one of the important assumption in KTG, okay, and while studying ideal gas, was that the molecules of ideal gas, okay, the individual volume of those molecules is much less than the volume of the bulk gas, or to say the volume between the molecules, empty spaces between the molecules, as a result of which we assume that volume of molecules tends to zero. Okay, it is not exactly zero, but molecules are simply point particles, and as a result of them being a point particle, we cannot actually measure their volumes, and we assume that volume is so slow that it is taken to be zero. But now this assumption will not be taken into account. Now we'll assume that this assumption is no more valid. Okay, which is true. This assumption was not a good assumption. Okay, and in fact molecules do have a finite volume which we might even be able to measure and use in our calculations. Okay, so molecules of ideal gas have a finite volume. They are not point particles. Instead, here we will assume them to be solid spheres. Okay, so in reality they are not even spherical in shape. Okay, they might have complex shapes, but we won't go into all that. Here we will assume that all the molecules of various real gases are solid spheres, okay, 3D spheres, right? And as a result of which, since each gas is different, like nitrogen, carbon dioxide, CH4, each of them have different number of atoms in them, each of them have different kind of elements in them, as a result of which the radiuses, okay, the radii of these solid spheres might be different, and hence the volume of molecules will now change from one real gas to another real gas. For ideal gases, we didn't make any such distinction, right? Avogadro law is applicable to every ideal gas, that volume depends only on number of moles under given condition of temperature and pressure. But now the volume will depend on the actual gas which you are taking inside your container. Okay, the type of gas matters. Next point, why there is deviation. The other important reason for the deviation from ideal behavior is intermolecular forces of interactions are present. Okay, up to now we assume that forces of attraction or maybe even repulsion, if they are there, will be zero. That is, one molecule of ideal gas doesn't affect, okay, the other molecule of ideal gas. But this assumption is also a bad assumption, and now we will not take that assumption anymore. From now onwards, we will assume that there is some kind of interaction. That means if one molecule of a real gas is traveling over here and there is another gas, which is another molecule traveling in this direction, then maybe this molecule will exert some kind of force on the other molecule, on the first molecule, and might even capture this first molecule towards itself. Okay, so this is force of attraction. There might be forces of attraction present between gaseous molecules. Alright, similarly, there might also be forces of repulsion present between gaseous molecules. Okay, and this is quite true. Okay, because we know that gases can be liquefied, and in order to liquefy the gases, there must be some kind of force of attraction between the molecules. Okay, unless that force of attraction is present, the molecules will not get liquefied. They will not come close together, okay, and stay that way. And so this can be seen as an empirical evidence to the presence of force of attraction, that gases can be liquefied. And once they are liquefied or even solidified, they are not easily compressible, right? As long as they are in gaseous form, as long as the gases are in gaseous form, the slight increase in pressure can result in great decrease in volume. But once they are converted into liquid or solid form, okay, then even a very high increase in pressure doesn't actually change the volume. The volume decreases by a very small amount, or it remains approximately same. So that means the molecules of in liquid or solid phase are trying to not come any closer. Okay, they are trying to remain apart, still apart. So that means there must be some kind of forces of repulsion involved now, and these forces of repulsion only came into picture when molecules were close enough to get converted into liquid or solid phase. Alright, in gaseous form, when molecules were further apart, these forces of repulsion didn't have any significant existence. So that means forces of repulsion are going to be short range force, which exist only at short distances. And once the distance between the molecules increase, okay, even by a very very little amount, the forces of repulsion are not acting anymore, and only forces of attraction are significant for us to take into account. Okay. So these two are the basic, okay, the most prominent reasons why there are deviations from ideal behavior, and why we have to study real gases separately. Okay, so what we are going to do is, we are going to devise an equation, just like we derived just like we saw ideal gas equation, we are here going to derive another equation which will help us predict the state of a real gas. Okay, that is, it will show you a relationship between pressure, volume and temperature of a real gas. Okay, and we'll see if it is possible for us to do that by ourselves. So some empirical evidence to deviation you can simply plot graphs, okay, of various gas laws if you like. For example, if you remember Boyle's law, you will know that pressure is inversely proportional to volume, okay, and the graph of P versus V, okay, if I plot graph of P versus V for ideal gas, it comes out to be a hyperbola, okay, of this kind. So what happens with a real gas? So let's actually take a real gas in a container and see how it behaves. And this is how the graph of ideal gas and real gas looks like. The red color line shows the graph of an ideal gas, pressure versus volume graph, which follows Boyle's law. Okay, this perfectly follows Boyle's law. Whereas the blue colored line shows the actual graph, okay, of a real gas. Alright, so the ideal gas concept is a theoretical model. It is based on our calculations, on our assumptions. Alright, but real gas is what we, the pressure volume graph is what we actually measure for the gases, what we can actually see in an experiment. And this is how it deviates. So still the pressure of even a real gas is inversely proportional to volume. That is, if we increase the pressure, the volume will decrease, but the amounts to which that volume decreases changes. Okay, and at times for a given pressure, okay, if say you plot a horizontal line over here, for a given pressure, the volume of real gas is much greater than volume which we might have calculated using ideal gas equation. Alright, but at other times they might be equal, that volume of real gas is equal to ideal gas, and at further lower pressures we see that volume of real gas is even lower than the volume of ideal gas for the given pressure, for the same pressure, okay, and assuming same temperature condition. Alright, temperature condition is constant, we can see that volume of real gas might even be lower than volume of ideal gas, but very slightly. Okay, so hence there can be deviations. So why is this deviation different at different pressure values? Okay, it is clear from the graph, at very high pressure values the volume of real gases tend to be very much greater than the volume of ideal gas. This means the volume occupied by the gas is more than the calculated volume. The calculated volume will be the one of ideal gas, okay, the one which we calculate using ideal gas equation, and the real volume will be the volume of the real gas, the measured volume or the experimental volume. So this volume is greater. This means there might be some kind of forces of repulsion acting at high pressures, very high pressures, which makes the molecules stay further apart than they actually want to. Alright, similarly at very low pressures volume of ideal gas either tends to be same as real gas, or the volume of real gas is slightly lower, okay, though they are still close enough. Okay, that means at low pressures these forces of repulsion stop acting and volumes are somewhat similar, but still the volume of real gas is lower than that of ideal gas because there are some kind of forces of attraction in real gases which brings the molecules somewhat closer than we expected. Alright. So this might be one of the reasons why there is this kind of deviation in the following graph. Okay, so let's see what else we can find out using empirical evidence. So another graph, if we again look at the Boyle's law, if you remember, we had also made a plot of PV versus P, right? And for an ideal gas, we know that PV versus P, or even PV versus volume, V graphs will be simple horizontal lines parallel to x-axis, right? That is, the product of pressure and volume, okay, for ideal gas is a constant, and that constant is in fact equal to nRT, but not so for real gases. Okay, for real gases this graph changes significantly. Let's see how. This is how the graph of ideal and real gas might look. The ideal gas graph is this horizontal line, okay, the graph of PV, product of pressure and volume versus pressure. Alright, so this is the graph for ideal gas. It is a simple straight horizontal line whose value will be equal to nRT. But under the same condition of temperature, and even if you take the same amount of moles, the graph for real gases varies significantly. In fact, if you look at over here, you will see that the graphs for different gases is completely different. For CO, CH4, H2, helium, four different gases have been plotted over here. Two of them, hydrogen and helium, show similar kind of deviation. They are both straight lines above the ideal gas line, and whereas carbon monoxide and CH4, okay, CO and CH4 are the other two gases which show same kind of graphs. That is, their graph first is below the ideal gas line, and then at after some value of pressure, this graph crosses the ideal gas line and has the product of PV greater than ideal gas after those pressures. Okay, so every real gas will have a different, a unique graph. We don't know how they might behave yet. Whereas for ideal gases, every ideal gas, whether we assume CO to be an ideal gas, CH4, if all these four gases are assumed to be ideal, then each of them will have the same horizontal straight line at same given temperature. Okay, which is this black colored line. Alright, so that means the deviations depend on the type of gas. The deviations are characteristic of a real gas. Okay, plus also these deviations are not same. Okay, they vary with pressure, and we'll see that they also vary with temperature significantly, and they might even vary with the volume. Alright, so all this we'll look at in the next few sessions when we'll study real gases in further detail. We'll come to this graph from a different perspective when we study compressibility factor, and we'll look at it in greater detail over there. Okay, so let's analyze, okay, a bit further why these deviations occur, so we have a better understanding of real gases. So first reason, if you remember, is forces of attraction and repulsion, which we have already seen that there is presence of forces of attraction as well as repulsion between the gas molecules, and because of those forces, the gas actually doesn't behave as an ideal gas, okay, or as we might have calculated, but rather they start behaving as real gases. Alright, so they might be closer, the molecules might be closer than we expected them to be in ideal gas, or they might be further apart than we expected them to be in ideal gas. Okay, so another point that we learned over here was that the repulsion forces are very short range forces, and they only exist when the pressure is high enough for molecules to stay close to each other. Okay, if you lower the pressure, the molecules get further apart. Okay, the empty space between the molecules increase, and at that distance the repulsion forces stop acting and only forces of attraction are present. Okay, and we also saw how deviations might depend on different values of temperature and pressure. Okay, later we'll analyze this temperature and pressure deviations in greater detail. Okay, we'll study something called Boyle's point, and we'll see how these deviations might be different at different pressure values also. Okay, so until next time, and once again, thanks for watching Edupedia World Videos.